Morning, church. Welcome to another Sunday service. I hope everyone is good today. So it's very welcome. We have another day together. I just want you to, before we start, just kind of take a deep breath, kind of just fill our lungs with air and then breathe out again. That is the gift of life, you know, and today I was just feeling that, like, you know, God is giving us this life, you know, the gift that we're able to still live. And it's a new day as well. So I just feel really blessed today to be able to come together and have Sunday service and also have communion as well. I was just thinking this week, I think it's like nearly the seventh or eighth week of staying indoors. And then there's like a lot of things just went through my head of what I want to do. You know, I want to see friends, I want to eat, and just want to just do a host of different things. And then I start to take a step back a bit and think about a lot of the things is always, yeah, it starts with what I want, you know, what I want to do, or it's kind of like me focused. And then you ask, you know, what does God want us to do? Maybe, and especially when we're seeing this, this kind of COVID, we're staying indoors, maybe God wants us to reconnect to each other. You know, maybe God wants us to kind of just calm ourselves down, have a moment to actually reflect on him. So as we continue on with our quarantine, maybe that's what God wants to meet you. And I hope you spend time with him and take this opportunity, because definitely in a few weeks or a few months, hopefully that when we get back to kind of our normal days, we may not have the opportunity or times for God. So to be able to use this time wisely and to reconnect with him as well. So the first slide for today is communion. Yeah, so please prepare our hearts for communion. Maybe if you have time now that you should get, you should prepare for two drinks or a drink and then something and the bread. Just a reminder that that we you know, practice communion for the people who are baptized. And if the people who aren't being baptized, I hope that it's a time for reflection. Maybe when it's time that you do get baptized, you're able to participate communion with us. But for the others, I give you probably a quick 30 seconds to a minute to kind of prepare. So please prepare your hearts and also prepare the wine and the bread. If you have notes or Bibles, you can also use this time now to grab them on hand. Pens, highlighters, whatever stationery that you need. Our next slide is Come Wait and Seek. So Come Wait and Seek is on, it's an evening of prayer, praise and worship. It starts on Friday, this Friday at 7:30 in this Zoom room as well. So people on Facebook, if you want to join us in Come Wait and Seek, please join the Zoom room, 320-320-3210. Yes, it's just a reminder of offering. If you haven't already done so, or if you want to join the offering online, electronic transfer details are here. Maybe we should pray before we start worship. So I'll start prayer. Father, thank you for this time. Thank you for this time we're able to meet up with brothers and sisters online, Lord. It's great, even though I don't really physically see them, but I know that we're all coming here together to meet with you, to listen to your word, to worship you. I pray, Lord, we're able to just have a united front, also keep the people who are suffering from the COVID, who are ill, who also passed away, Father. I pray, Lord, for people who are still in the front line, people who are still caring, people who are, the bus drivers or everyone who's going out there and still meeting with people. I pray, Lord, that you have protection over them. Also pray that that we're able to know that you're in full control of all the situation. May, Lord, that we're able to spend time with you during these times. I pray, Lord, that we're able to come together and be blessed with, by you, Lord. Father, I just want to pray that we're able to continue with praise and worship in Jesus' name. So I'm going to pass it on to Sophie, who's going to lead us into praise and worship.
Lord, I come. sin runs deep, your grace is more. When grace is found, it's where you are. And where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. Teach my song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, and when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay.
Just preparing to put songs together, and was looking at the sermon that Tommy had, and it's a really simple message that Tommy is going to share this morning, but one that I think is life transforming. And it's just about, you know, in this time we can get into good routines of spending time with God, and actually when you do and you hold on to that and you make it the foundation of your life, it really does change your life. And it's, you know, it's not this huge thing, and we're often trying to think of, you know, what can I do that will really set, you know, my faith on the right track. And actually it's as simple as just sitting with God, and letting him speak to you and just being with him. And there's nothing in my life that has been greater and sweeter than that. You know, you don't need the great emotional highs, you don't need conferences. You know, I miss church, definitely. I miss all of you guys and getting to do that together. But actually the thing that will sustain you through every season of your life is just sitting with God. And yeah, I just said the next song we're going to sing is just Better Is One Day. And it's the lyrics are just, how lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord Almighty, for my soul longs and even faints for you. For here my heart is satisfied within your presence. I sing beneath the shadow of your wings. And it's just such a beautiful song that we don't have to wait for, you know, eternal life to have that. It's the words of David, and it's just sitting with him. And it's that really simple for me. It's that picture of how a shepherd guides their sheep to green pastures and down by the streams. And it's just about daily provision and daily being safe in your Father's arms. So yeah, if that's not a place where you're at this morning, just say, like, look at this beautiful day that God has given us, and he's given us time to just sit and be with him, and we're so incredibly blessed. If this is what suffering looks like, I'm okay with it. You know, and my heart really does go out to, you know, I have a really good friend in India, and their lockdown looks so different. You know, they don't have a government that's able to provide in the same way that the Irish government is. You know, when they have nothing, they really have nothing. And it just makes me think the comparison that we have in this country, in comparison to a lot of other places. We are so blessed, you know, and it's just a reminder to pray for our brothers and sisters in other countries as well, but just to remember, you know, that God is a good God and a good Father to us.
How lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord Almighty, for my soul longs and even faints for you.
Song we've never done in church before, but it's called Give Me Jesus. I'm gonna play it. I have no idea whether you're singing anyway, but read the lyrics. And it was a song originally written a couple of hundred years ago, and it's just, I think, the most apt song for nowadays. And it just says, the main line is, it is take the world but give me Jesus. And I love that, and it's just a really beautiful prayer, I think, to have that, you know, you can take everything that is our world to us at the moment and everything that makes us feel normal and makes life feel like life, but give me Jesus. And I think that's, you know, that's my prayer this morning, for us as a church family. You know, God, take everything else, but just give us your son, and that's all we actually need. So yeah, if you just want to pray, or I have no idea what you're doing, but pray at home and just listen to this song.
Take the world, but give me Jesus. All its joys are but a name, but his love abides forever. Through eternal years the same, take the world, but give me Jesus, sweetest comfort of my soul. With my Savior watching over me, I can sing, low billows roll. Oh, the height and depth of mercy, oh, the length and breadth of love, oh, the fullness of redemption, pledge of endless life above. Oh, take this world, my God, to know. Shall be filled with clearer, brighter vision. Face to face, my Lord, I see. Oh, the height and depth of mercy, oh, the length and breadth of love, oh, the fullness of redemption, pledge of world, my God, to know. Take this world and give me Jesus in his cross, my trust shall be. Take this world and give me Jesus till that day. My Lord, I see. Oh, the height and depth of mercy, oh, the length and breadth of love, oh, the fullness of redemption, pledge of endless life above. So take this word, my God, to know.
And Father God, that's just the prayer that we have this morning. As everything that we consider to hold dear to ourselves, Father, that more than all of that, we just wanna know you. We just wanna sit at your feet and learn from you. We just wanna love you. We just wanna bring glory to your name. Lord, in this quiet time that you've given us, Father, you can give us the strength that when you take everything else from us, that we just lean on you and know that we're not lacking in any way. Father, that this isn't a prayer that comes easily to us. But God, I just pray that it would be something that would be a great joy to us and a great comfort, that we would know that we need nothing except from you. In your name we pray.
Amen. And good morning, everyone. Yes, good morning. And thank you for Kevin, for chairing and praying for us, and for Sophie for leading us and, you know, sharing her thoughts about the songs and also what God is speaking to her and to all of us. And it really is a joy to and a blessing to be able to come together online again and to be able to come beneath and listen to his words, come to at the feet of Jesus and to listen to his word. It is great to be able to just still have his word in front of us, even though we are all wherever we are. A huge welcome to everyone today, and I hope that we will all be blessed today through the passage that I'm going to share and preach. It's certainly a lesson for me to learn as well. And, you know, as we come through the COVID environment and, you know, this will probably end, and, you know, do we resume things the same way we did before, or have we learned something during this time, this so-called lockdown, this time where a lot of things are shut down, and that we would live or do life, you know, differently? So I'm going to just start with the verses today, and let us turn to God's word. The title of my sermon today is Stay Tuned. My last sermon was Look No Further, encouraging us to look to Jesus alone, to look to God alone for our salvation, to turn away from idols, and to, you know, this is a great, again, a time, a moment for listening to, seeking and listening to Jesus. And today's sermon, I titled it as Stay Tuned, and I hope that becomes clear why. So let us go straight to the passage, and we'll read it once through. I encourage you, even though I can't hear you, to read it out aloud together with me, and then we'll start with a prayer and then to the sermon proper. So the passage today is from Luke chapter 10, verse 38 to 42. It's a very well-known passage of two sisters. So it's been preached many times perhaps before. And but let's see what God is saying to us today through these verses, particularly in this environment. So we'll start reading it. Verse 38. As Jesus and his disciples were on their way, he came to a village where a woman named Martha opened her home to him. She had a sister called Mary who sat at the Lord's feet, listening to what he said. But Martha was distracted by all the preparations that had to be made. She came to him and asked, "Lord, don't you care that my sister has left me to do the work by myself? Tell her to help me." "Martha, Martha," the Lord answered, "you are worried and upset about many things, but few things are needed, or indeed, only one. Mary has chosen what is better, and it will not be taken away from her." Let us pray. Father Lord, we just want to come before your word, knowing that these are words you speak into our hearts through your Spirit. The word that is written is revealed and sheds light into our lives, into our hearts. That at this moment, in this time, where perhaps we finally, for some of us anyway, get a chance to breathe, as Kevin said, breathe, or to reflect, or to really focus and to be able to sit at your feet. That we want to soak up your word because your word reveals who you are. We know that the Spirit that is in us is going to use the word to just encourage us by revealing to us who you are. It is you, Lord, whom we want to see. It is you, Lord, who we want to listen. So may these words of my mouth and this meditation of my heart be pleasing in your sight, Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. I'd like to start today by conducting a quick survey, a so-called survey. Of course, we are all physically apart and it's not in a hall and I can't see people raising their hands or verbally hear you, what your response is. But I'm going to ask you anyway, a simple question that we ask all the time whenever we meet and greet each other. How are you? And I'd like you to take note of your own response, right? So even though I can't hear your responses or you can't see each other's responses, but I'd like to know and ask you to note for your own self, how are you? Of course, in this COVID environment, some of us may feel bored. Some of us will feel still very busy. Very often we just ask, answer the question, fine. So, you know, how are you? Fine, whatever that means. Sometimes we say bored, sometimes we say busy. As I said, in this COVID environment, I suspect probably with time, an increasing number of people will shift from the answer fine or busy to bored, but maybe that's not the case. And I certainly hope that not at the end of this environment and this lockdown and so on, that when we get back to so-called normal life, that's when we greet one another and ask one another, how are you, that we don't end up with us all saying busy. And you know, the world has for quite some time now, but lots of people who have conducted lots of research about just, you know, what is busy, what actually is busy or busyness, and whether it's Christian websites or non-Christian websites and research, you know, there's plenty of evidence to show that we are increasingly busy. People used to, you know, before the invention of clocks, would not have known what a second was or minutes and so on, etc. And they went about things based on seasons and so on. Fast forward a few thousand years and, you know, now everything is instant between noodles and Instagram and so on. And there are many, many theories or explanations as to why we hurry. And because I don't have enough time this morning, because I'm in a hurry, I'm just going to list out briefly here three of the reasons or theories or explanations as to why people are busy. And I'm not even going to explain them in that much detail because, again, I'm in a hurry. So people say we are busy for a few reasons, for many reasons, but here are three of them which I've picked today. So the first one is because busyness is a sign or reflection of your status. So even a century ago, leisure and free time and lounging in tennis courts or bowling or playing bridge and so on was a sign of wealth or high status. These days, though, there's a shift that, you know, people who are busy, you know, are wealthy or of a high status or power of influence. Like, you know, you have to be busy and productive and so on. So one of the reasons why sometimes we fall into the trap of being busy, maybe subconsciously, is because of this impression that we appear to be of a higher status, certainly more in the business world or corporate world and so on. Okay, the second one is busyness because of FOMO. So again, for all those of you who are not so young, it means fear of missing out. And people occupy themselves with, you know, many things, but two things that come to mind would be buying things constantly and have it all, and experiences, so done it all. And we just don't want any empty space physically or in our lives and so on. So FOMO, so we keep ourselves busy because of FOMO. And finally then, busyness is for show. It is good to show that we are busy as an outward sign of productivity or loyalty. And, you know, if we are deemed or if we consider other people's responses when we appear to be idle, we feel that we might be judged because we're doing nothing. And, you know, doing nothing is not allowed, especially in a Chinese heritage church like ours, right? And doing nothing is absolutely a crime. Now, I have started reading a book. I haven't got too far because I'm busy and I'm in always a hurry. I started reading a book called The Ruthless Elimination of Hurry by Pastor John Mark Comer. He's the same author as the book titled God Has a Name, which I know is slowly, and that's good, making its way around some of the, and in fact, some people are dying to get their hands on it, copy now. And I'm glad that it's being read not too quickly or in a hurry because there's so much good stuff in it. But anyway, for this book, The Ruthless Elimination of Hurry, John puts forward his argument that, you know, we really, as Christians, and he's a pastor, as Christians really need to ruthlessly eliminate hurry. Christina tells me, because she's read the book, and because I'm too busy and I'm in a hurry and I haven't read the book yet, how we've all, why we have all become so busy, the theories and the history and how it developed, why we're busy, and why is it an illness? And of course, he suggests some ways to tackle it. I'm not here to do a book review, so I'm going to go back to the passage and just look at what happened to Martha and Mary and see what we might be able to learn about what busyness or in being in a hurry might do to us. And as I say, I hope that this is something we will remember as we continue in this environment and so-called come out of this environment. Now, I want to say as well that this message today is not to counter or to oppose or to come against serving. And it is certainly not pitched against being hospitable, right? There are plenty of passages which encourages us to serve, and there are plenty of passages which encourage us to be hospitable. So this message is not about serving, this message is about serving that does become a problem or an obstacle between you and the Lord or you and others when it goes astray, when you're no longer staying in tune. And the primary problem is being distracted or being dragged away. So being distracted or dragged away from the Lord whilst we are serving, usually busily, usually in a hurry, even though it starts off good. So, as I say, to serve the Lord is good. There's absolutely no question about that. Jesus himself said, "I have not come to be served, but to serve." He is our servant king. He also frequently ministered to the sick and the poor from morning till evening, to the point in which he was tired and hungry. He actually got tired from his serving. So, there's absolutely nothing wrong with serving, even for hours or years or decades as such. But is there something missing in the midst of that serving? And if it is, then it might cause problem. Martha here, verse 38, opened her home to him. And I want to again reiterate that being hospitable is a necessity. It's a qualification for church leaders and so on. And it is good for Martha to have opened her house to Jesus. And Jesus is not going to scold her and reprimand her for having opened her house to him. Martha opened her house to him. It is good for Martha to have opened her house to him. If she had not done that, Jesus would not have come in and Mary would not have had a chance to sit at Jesus' feet to listen to him. And Jesus wouldn't have had a chance to compliment Mary. As I say, elsewhere in the Bible, there are plenty of passages which encourage us to be hospitable. So in other words, it is good to receive the Lord with open arms, to accommodate him, others in likewise fashion. To want him close to you, to look after him, to minister to those in need. But, and here is probably the main point, if in the midst of it, you get distracted, then you run into danger. If in the midst of it, you forget to do what Mary does here, which is to continue to stay in tune with the Lord, in this case, by sitting at the Lord's feet and listening to what he says, then you run into trouble. So in the midst of our busyness, so to speak, and hurriness, and really actually neither should be the case if we are actually in tune, easier said than done, mind you, if we stay in tune, then we won't end up the way Martha ended up. So let's look at it in more detail about what happened to Martha. So Martha was distracted. She opened her house. She wanted to receive the Lord and, you know, treat him well, which is obviously good. And it is obviously, you know, something that's, you know, we should aspire to in a sense of, you know, doing our so-called best for him. With all the preparations though, she got distracted. And the problem is this, when you're distracted, and the phrase used in the old text would be dragged away, you are dragged away by the other things, by the preparations, by the things that you feel needs to be done, dragged away from the Lord. So position, or, you know, imagine, so Mary sitting at the feet of the Lord, but Martha unable to sit at the feet of the Lord because she's dragged away. You then run into three other dangers or problems. The first one is this. The first problem with when you're distracted or dragged away is that you feel the Lord doesn't care. So Martha here says, feels that that Jesus doesn't care. She says it, Lord, don't you care? Lord, don't you care? And I'd like to invite you to consider or to reflect and think about, you know, and we are a high serving church. I think, you know, by my estimation, 80% of our congregation is serving and 80% of our congregation is involved, and that's a good thing, right? I'm not against serving again. But do we run into danger? Have you ever felt or said to the Lord, Lord, don't you care? Have you said to the Lord, can't you see that I am busy and doing my best to serve you, Lord? And I'm very busy and it is hectic, but you don't seem to realize or understand how I feel. And I'm sure that even as I ask these questions or say these questions, that you're probably realizing that there's something wrong with that question to Jesus, to accuse him that he's not caring or that he doesn't realize or he doesn't understand. And of course he knows, and of course he cares. But yet we are discouraged because in the midst of being distracted, of having lost hearing his voice and no longer being in tune with him, we stop hearing his love and care towards us. Jesus was speaking to Mary, but there's nothing to suggest that he wouldn't speak to Martha. Mary received because she was sitting at the feet of Jesus, and Martha could have done the same and sat at the feet of Jesus. Jesus, I'm sure, would not have so-called favored Mary over Martha, not the slightest. So it's when we are distracted, or as I say, dragged away, that we stop hearing from the Lord and his love and care, his teaching, his ministering, nurturing, and feeding of us with his very words. So the first problem with being distracted is because we end up discouraged. The second one is this. The second problem is division. So the first problem of being distracted is discouraged. The second problem of being distracted is division. Martha feels now that her sister has left her to do all the work by herself. Martha is now entering conflict with Mary. She not only defers, so she has chosen differently to what Mary has done, and Mary has chosen differently from what Martha has done, and you can talk about differences and so on, but she actually disagrees with the fact that Mary, in listening to the Lord, by sitting at the feet of Jesus, is actually at the same time simultaneously not acting or doing or helping Martha. So obviously when she's sitting there intently listening to the Lord, her inaction of preparing whatever it is that Martha is doing is, you know, goes hand in hand. So now, not only is she frustrated or discouraged by, you know, and feels that the Lord doesn't care for her, she is now frustrated because she has so much work to do, and she is now frustrated at her sister. As I say, to me, it's a conflict. You're not only having differences, but you're now disagreeing, and you are in conflict. You're in difficulty, right? Martha's not trying to be difficult. She's in difficulty. So the second problem of being distracted is that you feel that others also don't understand or don't care or have left you to do all the things by yourself. And again, in our highly productive church and high-performing and activity-based church, and not maybe just our church, but many churches, how often have we ever asked the question, why, Lord, am I doing all this work by myself? Why is that person not doing this work with me? Why is that person doing nothing, nothing? And that may be true. It may be. I don't know. It depends. Either way, let the Lord deal with us and deal with them. And yes, of course, in a journey that we take together as peers, we do try to influence each other, and that, I'm not dismissing that as well. But let us not end up entering into conflict with others, divisive with others, because of this. We're trying to serve the Lord together. So why are we ending up divided when we're still trying to serve the one Lord? So again, to recap, being distracted, the first problem is we are discouraged and we feel the Lord doesn't care. The second one is when we're distracted, we end up being divided with others, and that's we feel that others don't care or have left things for us to do. And the third one is this, the climax, the ultimate problem, right? The ultimate problem is this. When we are distracted, when we're really caught up in the things and we get flustered and we start fretting because we're not paying attention to the Lord, because we've been dragged away and the Lord is trying to say something or trying to teach something or trying to minister to us, and we are dragged away by the things that we have as a you know, agenda and so on. The final outcome is we actually dictate to the Lord what he should do. We actually dictate back to Jesus what he should do. So we're totally fully taking charge now, right? It's come to the end. Martha actually says to Jesus, tell her to help me. Martha has actually turned to her Lord and bossed him into telling Mary to help her. And her frustration was ultimately directed to the Lord. Have we done that? Have we gone from at first being discouraged and down or you know, disappointed and so on, to, you know, with the Lord initially, then to a stage where we also are discouraged or you know, disappointed and divisive with others? You know, in our midst of our good intentions and our desire to serve our Lord, you know, but we get hung up with, you know, certain details or micro stuff and so on. And ultimately, we even end up telling God, do this. I'm doing this for you, but do this. I've opened my house to you. I'm preparing a meal for you. I'm serving you, Lord. Now do this. Tell him, tell her to help me. Now, thankfully, despite all this, and despite all our frustrations and fretting and helplessness and being caught up and being discouraged or even divisive and dictating, Jesus does understand, and Jesus responds lovingly. He says to Martha, he responds lovingly and affectionately, repeating her name, Martha, Martha, and tells her plainly and simply what the issue is. You're worried and upset about many things. The problem, the distraction, the root thing is that you're worried. And the effect is that it's making you upset, or a lack of joy, or a lack of peace. You're worried, and now you're upset. And of course, we're not going to talk about a sermon of worry and so on, but we know that worry is wrong. We know that lack of joy and peace is wrong. So Martha, Martha, or my name, Tommy, Tommy, you are worried and upset about many things. But few things are needed, or indeed only one. And Mary has chosen what is better. You see, only one thing is needed, and that's to continually stay in tune. It is to continually be with Jesus. And sometimes, yeah, we are sitting there, really doing nothing else. Sometimes we are walking with him. You know, I think I'm allowed to say that, you know, it's okay to walk with him, to even fight your spiritual battles with him, alongside him against others, to run with it, fly with it, whatever you want to say. I mean, it doesn't matter. Feet, sitting, standing, eating, drinking. As long as you're with the Lord. And whilst with the Lord, you stay tuned. You stay tuned because you want to continually listen to him. Serving is okay. Being hospitable is okay. Even having somewhat of a packed schedule, I think, at times, may be necessary and okay, just provided that you can stay tuned. If you're able to, and we should work our life and schedule into so that, you know, you have your seasons and rhythms of you know, slightly more packed schedules and slightly less packed schedules, stay tuned. We need to always start with listening to Jesus. Whatever he tells us, that is what we do. Did he ask you to open your house? Good. Do that. Do that. Absolutely. Let people stay over. Invite them for meals. Did he ask you to stay at home to look after your children or your parents? Absolutely. Do those. Did he ask you to lead a group or be an active member of a group? Do that. Did he ask you to visit people, teach children, teach English? Do those. Did he ask you to study theology? And I'm delighted that our groups, many of our groups are doing the online IBI course. That's great. Do that. Is there a lot of material? Yes. Lots of videos? Yes. Is it hard to get your heads around it? Yes. But I believe that's what, you know, Lord has asked us as a church or groups to do. So let's do it. Yeah. Let's set some time, you know, aside and do it. Stay tuned. Did he ask you to witness for him in your work and college and workplace, or your school and workplace? Then do that. You see, it always starts with Jesus first, and Jesus continuously first. And you know, we sometimes come across the phrases, the cliche terms, you know, what would Jesus do, or don't run ahead of Jesus, or even follow the Lord. And you know, Jesus calls his disciples, come follow me. Well, if it's following him, then it means that he moves first and we go after him, and we go after him because we know where he's going, because we're listening to him, and then we follow. And now, of course, now you might be asking this, but how do I know what Jesus wants me to do? Well, for that, then you need to know him, and to know him very well. And if you ask then, well, how do we get to know him? Well, by listening to his word, by reading the word, the Bible that reveals Jesus, and as we pray and meditate and study its meaning, exploring its meaning, we're actually allowing God's Spirit, who is already in us as believers, to reveal who is Jesus and what he would do. Jesus himself did only what the Father ever told him. Jesus himself did only where the Spirit led him. And ultimately, that meant dying on a cross. And mind you, he did not die prematurely. Right? He didn't choose to die before his time. And he didn't die later. He did not choose to die a death of his choice, like sacrificing himself some kind of other hero. And, you know, no. He didn't choose his place of death. He knew that his Father had sent him to die, but it was none of it was his own choosing per se. He just simply walked with the Father in tandem, you know, avoiding arrest, avoiding publicity, and then later on, at the right time, allowing himself to be arrested and allow himself to be crucified. What he did, first and foremost, in the midst of all his serving, and I told you he served so-called, you know, morning till evening until he was tired, he just kept listening to his Father. He kept staying in tune. And that's what we need to do as well. We need to get our sequence right. Seek the Lord. So turn to him. Last time he said, turn away from idols and look no further. Turn to the Lord. Seek him. You find him. Now, this time, we say, listen to him and stay tuned listening to him and then serve. We have been in lockdown for almost 2 months and so many things have come to a standstill. But I think it is really, truly by God's mercy upon us to allow us to have come to this point where we can actually have a chance to pause and reflect. But at the same time, I also feel time is running out. On Friday, the government issues a roadmap of recovery from this lockdown. And soon, we will probably be faced with the temptations or fall into the trap of being distracted and dragged away all over again. In fact, if things go as planned, churches will be allowed, places of worship, churches will be allowed to be open from the 20th of July. And believe it or not, the PCT, we have already suggested that we can open our service from the 26th of July. And I absolutely look forward to that. Absolutely look forward to meeting everyone physically again. However, I just hope that we do not become distracted by all the preparations that we have to make for that time or even now. That we should not be so bogged down that we end up being discouraged or burnt out. That we should not end up risking disunity or division because we feel that there are things to be done, but others are not doing them or doing them differently, and so on, etc. And we should certainly not be jumping ahead of God and dictating to him what needs to be done, as if I was the boss or the Lord. Yes, there will be things that need to be done. There will be plans, but let's keep them under the Lord's feet. And whatever he tells us to do, we do. Whether it's a simple food or an elaborate feast, Jesus enjoys the company of his disciples, I believe. And we should enjoy his presence also. So today, we also now have our time of remembering the Lord and what he has done for us. It is our communion Sunday. And we are going to, you know, on this unusual way of doing it, have the communion. And because we have to go between screens and so on, I'm going to perhaps do more talking at a front part first. And communion is, just to explain for especially visitors who might be joining us, communion is primarily to remember the Lord Jesus, of what he has done for us by dying on a cross, his body broken for us, and his blood shed for us. It is to remember that he has died so that we can be reconciled with the Lord. We are redeemed. This is what Paul says. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." That means, as believers then, as Christians, we believe that the Lord Jesus has died. We proclaim his death. And we look forward expectantly for his return. And it is for us as Christians, and Christians only, who have been baptized, that you have professed and proclaimed your faith by also having been baptized and declaring that faith publicly, that we invite you to take the bread and the cup together. And Sophie will lead us in a song, and don't know whether the spotlight will be on me or not, but if it's on me, then I will take the bread and cup and people can follow suit.
Take the world, give me Jesus, all its joys, our burden name. Take, but his love abides forever, through eternal years the same. Take the world, but give me Jesus, sweetest comfort of my soul. With my Savior watching over me, I can sing though billows roll. Oh, the height and depths of mercy, oh, the length and breadth of love. Oh, the fullness of redemption, led your endless life above. To take this world, my God, to know. Take the world and give me Jesus. In his cross my trust shall be, till with clearer, brighter vision, face to face, my Lord I see. Oh, the height and depth of mercy, oh, the length and breadth of love, oh, the fullness of redemption, pledge of endless life above. So take this world, my God, to know.
Thank the Lord for his bread. For his bread that represents his body broken for us. Let us, brothers and sisters, take bread together. And we take the cup, which represents his blood shed for us, life poured out for us, so that our sins are forgiven and that we may be made whole again. Let us, brothers and sisters, take the cup together. Let me end with a prayer to ask Lord to speak to us and that we learn to stay in tune with Him, stay tuned to Him. But Lord, we want to be a people who are able to always listen to You. We want to be a people who are not just known for being busy or active and serving and, you know, it almost becomes showy and, you know, there are things to do, but we want to just listen each and every single step of the way what You'd like us to do. We don't want to dictate to You, we want You to dictate to us. We want to hear Your encouragement and we want to hear You encourage us to connect to each other and care for each other. And not to be distracted and dragged away from You or from others. We want You to let us become a people who are not just willing to serve, but also do so having sat at the Lord's feet. And that people can see that our serving is not by our own effort, our own attitude or mindset, but it's because, Lord, You have sent us. So help us, Lord, during this time, and also in the times to come, to continue being stay in tune. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of Father God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with each and every single one of us this day, this week, and forever and ever, this season, next season, season to come, and until You return or we get called home. We pray this in Your name. Amen. The Lord bless you all. And you're more than welcome to join us in our Zoom room, chat room, for your own cup of tea or coffee or biscuits and refreshments, but then also with fellowshipping with one another. Blessings to all. The Lord bless you. Amen.